There's a certain time of day and a certain time of year when the sun sets and the weather cools, when the leaves change and the winds chill. Light retreats, darkness advances, and imagination takes over. It all occurs during that brief period of time known as...
the Twilight-tober Zone.
We're starting off year four of Twilight-tober Zone with an episode called 4 O'Clock. Only in the zone, baby. And yet another of the numerous evergreen moral stories this show had to offer, this installment displays a few scarily strong parallels to modern times through some trademark exaggeration. Oliver Krangle is a man who lives on his own with his pet parrot, Pete. He spends his time making calls to expose people he deems evil.
Communists! Suppressives! Thieves! Harlots! Evil. All of them.
Over the years, Krangle has collected a vast filing system of names with information about them attached. He'll usually phone the person's employer to reveal their sins in hopes of getting them fired. Through a sheer act of will, he proclaims to his parrot that at 4 o'clock, he'll shrink down all the evil people in the world to 2 feet tall. That way, they'll be distinguishable from the decent population and be easier to spot and apprehend by authorities. The wife of one of his targets, Mrs. Lucas, stops by to try and plead with him to stop his constant attacks of her husband, a doctor who wasn't able to save a patient. Krangle is crude and void of remorse. Seeing he's off his rocker, she leaves. Soon, an FBI agent named Hall arrives, and Krangle tells him about the conspiracy all these evil people are devising. When he mentions his plan to shrink them down to be spotted by the law, Hall questions his sanity. Krangle loudly accuses him of being a part of the conspiracy as the agent exits. Eagerly peering out the window, Oliver waits for the clock to strike 4 so he can watch his plan take effect. Rod Serling adapted this script from Price Day's 1958 short story. It first appeared in Alfred Hitchcock's Mystery Magazine before being selected for the director's My Favorites in Suspense book a year later. It certainly feels like a Serling script, with its message-heavy story and peculiar central player. Oliver Krangle even sounds like one of those odd names Rod would come up with. In the short story, Krangle's first name isn't mentioned, so we can at least attribute half of this guy's designation to Serling. This was director Lamont Johnson's 6th installment in the 3rd season alone, with one more to go. In fact, we're going to be talking about that one next. He did get to head up one of season 4's hour-long episodes, too. We'll take a look at Passage of the Lady Anne later this month. Johnson seemed to work well with character pieces that focused on one eccentric lead. Nothing in the Dark and even portions of One More Pallbearer come to mind. Since this pretty much all takes place in Krangle's apartment, you can also draw comparisons to other claustrophobic sets in some of his other shows, like 5 Characters in Search of an Exit and the basement location in The Shelter. Theodore Bickel brings Krangle to life on screen with a fascinating manic performance. This is helped by his attire, especially those Coke bottle glasses that give Henry Bemis a run for his money. Krangle is equal parts obsessive, self-righteous, and sadly, somewhat recognizable.
Because they're evil. That's it. There's nothing complicated about that. They're evil.
This is one of the more distinct lead portrayals in a TZ episode that I don't think a lot of people talk about. Bickel is all over the place in a good way, with his sheer intensity driving the story.
How does evil spread? By public transport. So I had it in mind that I might take the stiffness out of airplane propellers. Props hanging limp, like empty banana skins.
He comes off sincere in his deranged convictions, which can make his unhinged behavior read as both frightening and funny, often at the same time.
At 4 o'clock in the afternoon, at precisely 4 o'clock, every evil man and woman will be exactly 2 feet tall. Revelation. An absolute revelation.
His constant babbling of a conspiracy infiltrating every facet of life, his harsh judging and overgeneralization of others without truly knowing their situation, the incessant phoning of not just the employers of those he deems evil, but harassing the targets themselves, and even the whole visual setup of a person alone in their home, obsessed with causing misery for others, sure as hell sounds like some spaces on the internet, doesn't it? This guy was basically a one-man Twitter mob. I think at the time the short story was written, this was a response to the infamous McCarthyism of the 1950s, where the Red Scare had accusations flying all over the place with many people in fear of losing their livelihood. Krangle directly mentions communism several times.
A young man named Alfred Brewster. That's right, been with you about a year and a half. Man's a communist.
I'm sure part of the intention was a more general and direct cautionary tale, but the time period informs a lot of what we're seeing. That doesn't make it any less relatable to contemporary online discourse, though. As Krangle gloats over his grand scheme, 4 o'clock finally rolls around, when Pete calls for a nut.
Suddenly, Peter, this is kind of a celebration.
Oliver has found himself to be 2 feet tall. Krangle's massive act of will has turned against him. He breaks down in hysterics as he reaches in vain for the glass of nuts on the windowsill. I know this is a predictable twist, but it's effective, and I really like the execution. Seeing this guy get what's coming to him is a satisfying conclusion for a masterfully crafted, unlikable main character. Bickle's over-the-top facial expressions and pathetic yelps, combined with the music cue here, make for a great finishing sequence. And I love the use of the giant windowsill set. Those shots sell the ending perfectly. The cherry on top of the sundae is Pete calling for another nut, putting into question if the bird was really insulting Oliver throughout the whole episode. This is a show that needs more love. The correlation to any era with unfair judgment of our fellow man is valid, but geez, does it feel appropriate to some of today's overall internet attitudes? What do you think? I'd love to hear your thoughts, no matter what time it is, because it's always 4 o'clock somewhere in the Twilight Zone.